right. Thanks, John. So as John said, I'm Andy Hamilton. I'm a Durham-based product designer. So currently, I am working at a real estate startup that uses predictive analytics to determine how likely someone is to sell their house in the next 12 months, and they sell that information to real estate agents. But that's not what I'm here to talk about today. Before joining the first team, I had been doing product design consulting for the last 10 years. So I spent time here in the Triangle as well as in Boston. So that allowed me to do a lot of work in the healthcare space. When I started, I was mostly doing hardware, but made the switch to software about 3 years ago. So today, I'll give you a little intro about myself. I'll show off some of the work that I've done. I think there's really interesting similarities between how you develop a physical product and a mobile experience. Even though kind of the tools and the output is different, the process is really similar. So I'll talk about some of the things that I've learned doing that process. So that's me. I graduated from the College of Design at NC State with a degree in industrial design. So at first, I was doing physical goods. This is a reskin of a blood pressure monitor. So really, they just needed to update the look and feel of the device to match the technology inside. There wasn't really any new features that we were building. It just needed like a refresh so that it would look good inside a, you know, an office. This product I'm going to talk a little bit more about later is a digital ear scanner. So when I was in Boston, I was working with a company called Boston Device, which would take products developed in labs at MIT and spin them out into medical devices and products that could be like bought, used, you know, and improve patient lives. So it was really fun to go from a working alpha, something that would like work in a lab setting, but then devise the right packaging for that product so that it would be desirable, useful, and effective. This is a desktop spectrometer that would do material identification. So basically validating that the ingredients that you're using in your lab or for medicines are the correct ones. I thought this was kind of cool because you know, you'll notice there's a lot of blue here because all of these products are in the medical space, so that's a very like safe, approachable color. But the form factor that we chose to use here is pretty interesting because it's kind of like a tablet and kind of like a handheld device that has to reach into small spaces, but it also has a really nice dock where you can leave it on the countertop and bring materials up to it. So as John mentioned, I started a mobile device, a mobile design consultancy in Boston about 3 years ago. And we did work with Twitter and a number of startups on the East Coast, on the West Coast. And a lot of the projects in the healthcare space were you know, patient-reported outcomes. So it was a lot of work and a lot of effort for, you know, patients to record kind of like their healthcare outcomes, provide that information to their you know, professionals, you know, their care team, and have this fit into their you know, daily life. So reducing touch points, making this, you know, frictionless, trying to make this fun and interesting, driving compliance in the profile view here, and then also showing them their actual provider inside the application was a big part of it. This is a basically like a fitness tracking app where you can share your condition with your coach so they know how ready you are to be in the game. Cool. All right. So basically what I've learned doing these kinds of projects is that design's role is really to synthesize the needs of these three stakeholders. So there's the user, the business, and then the implementation team. And so what's important is that you're adding value to a user, because if you're not delivering them value, they're not going to actually be engaging with your product. So if it doesn't satisfy their need, it doesn't really matter that you put all the time and energy into making it. Another component is the business goals. So if you're not generating revenue, your product is not going to exist for very long. So this is another assumption and another you know, criteria that you need to be designing for constantly. And then finally, the realities of implementation. So whether that's actual device manufacture, getting costs down to something that's reasonable, or implementation through a mobile device or a web product, understanding how it's going to be built and implemented is a really important lens to apply to your designs as you evaluate them and iterate. So Lantos, this is the 3D ear scanner, and I'll kind of go through this and one other project from a process perspective so you can kind of see what happens as we go from lab technology to medical device in the hands of professional audiologists. I always start with really good reference material. So I think finding examples of how this problem has been solved inside the space that you're working in, and especially outside the space in other worlds. Where have other people attempted to solve the same problem is a great place to look for a reference and inspiration. So here I was looking at handheld devices, different form factors for a pistol grip, whether it's a tablet grip, all these different kind of form factors around a handle that would drive inspiration as we move into like an ideation phase. So after you've kind of immersed yourself in that landscape, you want to apply what you've learned to like a variety of potential concept directions. So generally, I would use like hand sketching, a lot of whiteboard sketching now, just to get things down quickly and share these ideas with other people. I think what's really important is that when you're designing, you're always making artifacts. So you need to produce something that can be shared, because the synthesis of those stakeholders is really at the root of what you're doing. And without something tangible to show, even early in the process, it's really hard to get good feedback. I mean, even the reference and inspirational material, this is a great way to get the conversation started quickly. You know, you can be looking at specific features, colors, details, all that stuff. It helps you move forward very, very quickly. So now that we've generated all these potential directions forward, being able to post them up and evaluate them against our requirements. This is, you know, low stakes. You want to have a lot of different ideas, and actually letting them win on their merits is what's most important, not who came up with what. And you just want so many that you're not really, like, married to any one. Like, you don't want to really, you know, champion one if it's not the right solution. You really want the best solution to emerge as you move forward. So in the physical space, it's really fun to move right into actual like prototyping in tangible elements. So these are 3D printed handhelds and foam models. So you can get an idea of like how it will feel, what a distributed form factor might be like. If you were to wear it on the hand, what would that be like? And then you can get those in front of people. So whether they are potential users or whether it's even the implementation team, getting feedback from your developers or your engineers early on helps kind of guide a direction that's going to be really fruitful. Now with all this information, we're just kind of like iterating around like getting closer and closer to a solution. So here I've basically applied some rough geometry of the internals and started putting a skin around that based on some of the initial form mockups that we move forward with. So this is a more finalized, this is the CAD actually of the actual device. And really the end goal of what we were working towards is having a functional beta that we could go demo at a trade show, but then also do more long form, like long-term studies with, and make sure that everything was doing what we wanted. So the way this works, which is kind of neat, is this is actually, there's a little balloon at the end of that tip, and it inflates with fluid. And so an audiologist would place this in your ear, hit the retract button, and a laser would scan the interior of your ear geometry. And then they would be able to send that information to a hearing aid manufacturer or a headphone manufacturer and reduce the amount of time it takes to go from needing one to actually receiving one. Because the way that you would get a hearing aid made up to this point was you would actually put a silicone mold in your ear. And so you'd have to sit there, wait for it to dry, pull it out, and then mail it, and then they would then scan it, manipulate it, make your hearing aid, and send it back, but there was always issues, and this was a really long lag time. So the idea was that this would reduce the amount of time to you receiving your hearing aid, and also improve the quality, because you're sending digital files and not making a copy of a copy. So here's us putting the beta together. This is really the most fun and exciting part when everything starts coming together. since these were, you know, short run, this wasn't for designed for mass manufacture. These were really expensive, so assembling this product was really interesting. Here's kind of like the final like functional model. This picture was actually used in Wired. We got written up for this project, and that's my hand. So I'm a hand model and a designer. The next product I'll talk about is more closely aligned with what we've been hearing about from the other speakers today. Clio Health was a Boston-based startup that wanted to allow patients to track chronic pain conditions. So there was a patient side and a provider side to the application, and like a lot of people have been mentioning, you know, that's a lot of effort and a lot of work. And at this time, you know, asking someone to record all of their symptoms, triggers, you know, outcomes was a lot of, you know, effort. So we put a lot of time and energy into trying to reduce the touch points and increase their ability to communicate with their provider when they would go to a visit. So this was before, you know, any healthcare integration, the EHR integrations were on the table, and a printed report was really what we were shooting for at the end. So much like the ear scanner, you start with good reference, and I think I've seen, you know, Clue, I love that app. There's all different, you know, great reference out there. So just start with, you know, who solved this problem already? What are some of the patterns that people are familiar with? What do we know development teams are good at executing on? As these, you know, there's just so many healthcare apps, but it does, you know, you get to see patterns around what are good solutions around driving compliance, making buttons big, easy, and simple, having, you know, like text that supports what you're supposed to be doing on any given screen. Quick hand sketches, again, is a way to get ideas down. I mean, your first is always your worst, so you want to get as many as you can down so you can move on to the next thing. We spend a lot of time focusing on primary workflow. Thinking about what a user is going to do every single time they open the application, I think, is really important, and that's where you should start. This should also be consistent with what is unique about the product or service that you're offering. If you're not emphasizing what's unique, you're just going to get like lost in the crowd. So making sure that nth time use, that every time use is really good and really solid is generally where we would start. Then you can just rely on best practices for some of those like secondary workflows like profile, account, onboarding to some extent. And then making sure that your solution works for your users. Here, after we focused on the primary workflow, we wanted to design, make sure that the design also fit for, you know, the desktop workflow. This product had a patient side and a provider side. The assumption was that the patients would engage primarily with the mobile app. The provider would engage with a desktop interface. But I think the reality is that providers don't actually have time to go to another place to look for this information. And what we found was that the printed reports, which were just kind of a feature or an idea, actually became the most important piece of this project. So prototyping, I think, is huge. And there are lots of great tools to make this, you know, really easy. We would use Envision, which is basically a web-based prototyping tool, which would allow you to send, you know, links between screens to anyone. So you can get feedback the day that you've done the work from someone who's, you know, not there. And then also being able to share that with users like right away. So, you know, moving quickly, not being afraid to break things, that helps. So here's a refined look and feel for the primary workflow. These are some of the components, basically all the different entry widgets that you had inside the application. I got to illustrate poop, which was cool. Yeah. There we go. That's the final kind of, you know, look and feel. But again, this was what was really valuable, is understanding that the doctor's workflow wasn't really going to change, but making it easy for a patient to bring this information with them to a visit, whether they go and print it out or they just open the application, allows them to get a lot further, a lot quicker when they start talking about chronic conditions, which can sometimes be very hard to quantify and talk about. So how can you use this information? I would say always start with great reference material when you're trying to solve a problem. Think about ways that other folks have solved it in other times, in other industries, in other cultures. That will really get the juices flowing. Always show and don't tell. So, I mean, by basically having something for someone to react to, you can start gathering that feedback and improving on your solution. Focus on the primary workflow. What does someone do every single time they're using the application? Don't get lost in the weeds with all the other stuff. Just use best practices for everything outside of primary workflow. Emphasize what's unique. Prove it at a low fidelity. I really like this one. And this had a lot to do with doing like the hardware development. If you couldn't get a concept to work at a really low fidelity with just like paper prototyping, foam mock-ups, then you can't just assume that when you spend more time and money on it that it'll actually work better. So the solutions that are working well at a low fidelity tend to only improve as their fidelity increases. And has been mentioned before, always be improving. I feel like design is never really done. In the software world, that is a lot easier because you can release updates and you can make changes on the fly. In hardware, you really have to get it right by the time you cut the tooling to actually go into production. So that's why validating all of your assumptions and the decisions that you've made before you get to that point is really, really important. And that's it. Thanks.
No, lunch is, everyone's stomachs are gurgling. Didn't know, if were there any kind of quick follow-up questions for Andy? I think a couple of tools that he mentioned, one in particular is Envision, something that all of you should be familiar with and playing with. It's free. It's very easy to spread ideas very quickly. A more professional tool called Sketch that Andy's exposed me to. It's $99 to download, but it's how you create all these great screenshots and all the screens that you can see. Anyone can learn it. There's a lot of self-help videos on the internet to help you learn the tools really quickly. And then using whiteboards and putting a bunch of sticky notes up on the wall is the best way to kind of begin to build that reference board and then save those in Envision or a PowerPoint. Just take screenshots, put them together. Are there any other follow-up questions or comments to Andy? All right, I'm sure he'll be around in the noon hour to talk more about some of his approaches and tools.